For joining me on a very special stream tonight, because for the last couple of weeks, 17 weeks to be exact, I've been doing Dance Mix NYC vinyl classics. I first started just playing all vinyl. Eventually, over time, we started introducing other media because I was just running out of vinyl, so I started playing some CDs and stuff. But interesting, last Sunday I did a battle of the divas where we had 12 divas from Whitney Houston, Deborah Cox, Toni Braxton, Tamia, Mary J. Blige, and it went very well. So it made me think, what if we did a battle of the remixers? Taking remixers from the 90s to 2005. And what better way to figure out who the top remixers are is to bring somebody that knew these remixers both professionally and personally. So today I'm really honored to have the legend, industry legend, Hosh Gureli. Hosh, good to see you.
Hi, Rich. Good to see you. I don't know about legendary because I would put that name with some other people that we might be talking about today, but that's very kind of you. I'm just happy to play a part in dance music because I enjoy it so much.
For those that don't know who Hosh Gureli, like, can you kind of give us a little rundown of, you know, how you got in or what you've been doing in the industry?
I am a native New Yorker, grew up in the New York area, went to college in Boston for radio and TV. I ended up saying, okay, let me stay in Boston. I became a very big club DJ there. Then I segued into radio, and I worked at Kiss 108. And then from Kiss 108, I got the music director job at KMEL in San Francisco, which at that time, that was late 80s, early 90s, was like the premier station because we were independent. We were able to play records like The Power, Gonna Make You Sweat, before anybody else, as imports. We didn't have a big conglomerate looking over our shoulders. And I continued to be a club DJ there, working at the biggest club, which was Colossus at the time. And I had an underground mix show as well. And I had the opportunity to bring on a lot of the New York-centric DJs of the time live on my show. And also we hosted live events outside at the club. And, you know, they performed live. After that, I came back to New York and was A&R for Clive Davis at Arista Records, where I had the opportunity of working on a lot of great artists. And because I was in the dance, like the dance thing, I commissioned, you know, all the remixes for that during a 15-year period.
I mean, you could not, I could say this, like, I don't think there was not one single DJ that has never, they've at least played at least 10 of your remixes in their lifetime. I would, and that's being generous, I would probably say at least 100 of your remixes in their lifetime.
You know, I did it for the love. What can I say? You know, it's wonderful to hear that. But, you know, I think the reason why we had success is because, you know, I lived it. I mean, I was there in the streets and with a lot of other colleagues, and we had fun doing what we do.
So this Sunday, like I was saying, we are doing Battle of the Remixers. So I decided to do a 16 bracket kind of March Madness style style layout. And let me just share that right now.
You know, you did the Divas last week. I didn't even know you did it. And you said Deborah Cox won. I mean, I would have loved to have seen that play out.
You know? Yeah, you know what? It's, I mean, it was kind of like a last minute thing, to be honest with you. I was like, Sunday night, right before I hopped on, I was like, you know, I'm going to switch things up. And I probably should have made it, gave it a little more fanfare, because it was a lot of fun. And that's the reason why we're doing this now. I mean, doing the Battle of the Divas was so much fun because people were in the chat, you know, just giving their opinions and, you know, and just talking about their memories of Deborah Cox. Like, people were saying, oh, I remember seeing her at Sound Factory. Oh, I remember seeing her at, you know, Arena, blah, blah, blah. It was fun. It was a lot of fun. And I'm glad that she actually took it all. It was close. It got down to Deborah Cox and Whitney Houston. And, you know, yeah, two of your girls right there. And it was, that was an epic battle, to be honest. It was fun. And it was great to hear the music too. That's what the best part of it is. Like, as I'm playing songs and remixes from, you know, the different divas, and it just brings an emotion to everybody that was on the stream. So it was a lot of fun.
You know, I think being a remixer back then, or a remixer producer, I think a lot had to do, you know, yeah, there wasn't social media, but, you know, they were pressed on vinyl.
Yep.
And, you know, there was an art to going to the different clubs with the acetate or the test pressing and handing it to the DJ and it doing something special and things organically blowing up from that, which unfortunately doesn't exist today. So, you know, there were times when I was at the club, and I'll tell you when as we go through the different DJs, where I knew that where I was and where the whole crowd was, we were at the most happening place in the entire world. I knew that there was no place better that was like on fire at that. And that was special. And that happened through New York, you know, for quite a few years. And neither you, and it's not like, maybe that does exist in a different way, we just don't know it.
Yeah, I would, not to sound like a boomer, but I don't think there is going to be like that experience again. And we'll talk about that as, like you said, as we talk about the different remixers. Speaking of which, like I said, we're going to do a Sweet 16. And it was really hard, really, in the beginning when I was thinking about this. Oh, man, there's so many great remixers that should be on this list. And then there was also people that were also suggesting, oh, you need to add some of the European Remixers, but I wanted to keep this New York City focus because in this era, quite frankly, I feel like the New York City producers and remixers really were the ones on top of it at that, in this time frame, in the club, in clubland here in America, at least. Just my opinion.
I would agree with you. I mean, they dictated, and I would make the caveat that they are producer / remixer, because
right,
a lot of them made their own records.
Right.
I think contributed. You know, some people might say, well, why aren't you including Sasha or Digweed? Because as the 2000s hit, there was a European influence, mm-hmm, Paul Van Dyke, et cetera. But I'm happy to play New York City, baby.
So am I. That's why I got it in my background, as you can see. As you can see here, we have our Sweet 16. I kind of wanted to like make it a little even. I mean, it could have been so easy for me to do house versus big room, but as you'll see with the brackets, I wanted to kind of mix it up so that way it's a little more balanced. So on our first bracket, we have David Morales.
I want to give it up to David, who still to this day is doing it. I worked with David I was in the studio with David when Aretha Franklin cut vocals. But David, to me, when I got the remix, and I was still, you know, at KML, when Dream Lover came out, I thought that that was the most awesome remix. And I still, if you were to ask me what the best remix of all time is, I would say Dream Lover, because Mariah went in, totally recut the vocals, recut the chorus, and it became a record unto itself. And I looked at that, you know, when I got to Arista and RCA, as like, that's how we got to make records, you know? So, you know, that's my take on David. I think he's a legend.
Yeah, I mean, speaking of which, like, that was what I always loved about Morales' mixes. Like, whenever he worked with, like you said, like a Mariah, like, the artist would recut the vocals. He wouldn't just stretch them. They would come in and recut them and just had that David Morales touch to it.
You know, when we did Who Do You Love, and to his credit, we had the first version, which didn't have that signature intro, that dun, 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 dun. The first version didn't have that. And he went back in and like, you know what, Hosh, I want to make another version that's a little bit more iconic. And that's where it really took off with a bomb, 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 which is, you know, Things Just Ain't the Same, probably her big breakout underground hit, but I think that Who Do You Love was, you know, that started things going.
Well, it brings us to the next bracket, which we have Masters at Work.
Little Louis Vega and Kenny Dope Gonzalez. You know, I don't know if I ever hired them directly. Again, I've interviewed them. They've played at my club. I've interacted with them throughout the years. Look, the stuff that they did with India was amazing. I think that, again, they are in that class with David Morales. And I know another person that you're going to reveal later. He's also in that class.
Just looking at their discography, you know, I was on Discogs, over 1,000 remixes. And, I mean, everyone from Daft Punk to Janet Jackson, and they're still doing their thing today. I mean, look at Louis. He's like streaming like crazy, and
he's on the New York City reset. He killed it. He's doing a lot of stuff with Mike Nervous and Benny Soto, and he is as much active today as he's ever been.
Yeah, so much props to them, and that's why they're on our list on our Sweet 16, which well, now comes to our next producer, Honey.
Honey, remix Share the Love by Andrea Martin. I don't remember how Honey and I met, to be quite honest. Maybe he reached out to me. But I remember he had a studio that was right near the Lincoln Tunnel. It was in a basement. And, you know, Andrea Martin had this record called Share the Love that didn't become a hit on radio, but Hani was able to transform it into definitely a New York club hit. I mean, this was an anthem. It got played at a lot of clubs. And, you know, it was the start of a great relationship. Hani, you know, himself is kind of a low-key kind of guy. He's very spiritual. And he went on to do records like Diary by Alicia Keys, which I think is amazing.
I worked at Tommy Boy at the time, and you know, he did Amber One More Night, which was a really big remix for us. But you know, looking at his discography, it looks like he did like Pink, There You Go, did the Beatles, he did a Eleanor Rigby remix, Backstreet Boys, Justin Timberlake, Christina Aguilar, Firefighter, Kelly Clarkson.
Bad Mama Jamma mix that had, who did that?
She's a Bad Mama Jamma. Yeah, Carl Kaufman. Yes. Yeah, I forgot that he did that. Yeah.
That was also kind of, I don't know if we cleared that sample or not, but
that probably would have cost a lot of money to clear that sample.
Another one of our white label things.
Speaking of which, you know, going to that real quick, when you had remixers sample things, what was your, like, your first response, like, first thought, like, were you like thinking, cool, but oh no, we got to pay for this sample?
You know, we paid for the samples if they were good enough.
Right.
Now that I remember, we tried to clear the Carl Carlton and he wouldn't clear it. So I think we just promoed that one.
Right.
But we did, I remember there was an It's Not Right remix that we cleared a sample for from Salsoul. I think it was $25,000 at the time.
Wow. That
was a C remix. So look, and later in working at the label, they had musicologists who would like really search. But you have to remember, there was a lot of sample that got away. I mean, Todd Terry's whole career was made on sampling stuff, and I don't think he ever got in trouble. And even Puffy, I mean, Puffy kind of ruined it for everybody once he.
Yeah.
Did those big samples, and you know, he obviously had to pay big money for it. And then everybody's like, what other records are having samples in them?
Yeah. But Hani, yeah, he had some incredible remixes and very memorable remixes. So we definitely had to have them in our Sweet 16.
Love me some Hani.
Which brings us to our next remixer, Todd Terry.
And that's what I was talking about. Todd Terry. I mean, every time you hear Can You Party, it's Todd Terry.
Yeah.
I mean, Todd put out so many records during the late 80s and early 90s. He sampled whoever he wanted. A lot of stuff on Warlock. Never hired Todd. Big fan. Friend of Todd's. Also, you know, again, before I went to Arista, you know, KNEL was looked at as breaking a lot of records, a lot of New York records. And that's because I brought all these guys in and flew them into San Francisco, and we played the shit out of their records. So, you know.
I mean, for me, it's like, I mean, like you said, like he's such a legend from the 80s, but like I remember getting Everything But the Girl, and like that was the version everybody played, like radio, clubs, like they didn't even play the original. It was Todd Terry's remix of
That is a great example, and that was one of the few times when the remix was bigger than the original and was the version.
Yeah, it became like the version, and I think that to me was, I mean, there are remixers, obviously. Remixing has been going on for years, even before Todd, but I think when Todd did Everything But the Girl as a remix, it kind of like opened the floodgates maybe to labels doing more of these remixes, maybe, would you say?
I would. What year was that?
I think that was right around 95, maybe, or 94. No, 94. It was 94.
I would agree with that. I think the three, I think the Mariah Carey Dream Lover, I think Missing, and when I had an opportunity to do Unbreak My Heart. It's after Unbreak My Heart that
yeah.
Labels, because that was a big, wait a minute, this thing really is working and it's reaching a different audience. So I think all three of those, yeah, for sure.
Our next bracket, we'll go back to the right side. Jonathan Peters.
Jonathan! I love Jonathan. Definitely a friend. My memory of him is the work that we did with My Love Is Your Love. I had Thunderpuss also do it because we had great success with the obviously It's Not Right, It's Okay. And I had Jonathan asked to do it. And I'm like, sure. Gave him the stems. We worked on that record for a very long time. I remember being on vacation in the Bahamas and, you didn't have the internet like you do today. And I was getting FedExes of edits and things. And we worked very closely together on getting the right mix down, the right sound. When you say I'm being a little tough, sometimes there definitely was a lot of going back and forth on that. But we nailed a great edit, and he got his long version. And Jonathan's work speaks for himself. When the second incarnation of Sound Factory on 46th Street, he has his own generation of loyal following, and gotta give it up to him.
Yeah, I remember Jonathan, he would come into the Tommy Boy offices to see Victor Lee. Hey, baby. And it's like you said, he had such a cult following at Sound Factory. And to this day, still.
Yeah. And he also did Same Script, Different Cast, which was awesome.
Yes. Actually, that's the version I played in the finals between Deborah Cox and Whitney. So I played one Whitney song, one Deborah song, and then I played Same Script, Different Cast before we voted on who was going to be the actual winner. And that was a Jonathan mix that I played. So
that doesn't get enough shine, I don't think, that mix. It's an amazing mix.
Yeah.
I'm glad you played it.
All right. So in this round with Jonathan, we have him going up against Johnny Vicious.
I love me some Johnny Vish. We worked on quite a few things together. If you go back really early, he did Just Be Good to Me, which I think might have been the first or second remix on Deborah Cox. There's so many with Johnny. And Johnny's incredible. A memorable one for me is when he did No Mercy, Kiss You All Over, because I took that acetate and just wrote NM on it, okay? I go to Twilo, I go up in the booth, what's up, Junior? Hand Junior the acetate. Junior needles through it right after I give it to him. It's the next record. He plays the thing for 45 minutes.
Wow.
Everything destroys it. He doesn't know it's No Mercy. It's a fake out. And that was an amazing moment. And we ended up having No Mercy perform the Johnny's version at Twilo. Another great memory was when he did his version of It's Not Right, But It's Okay. We worked quite back and forth on that a lot. I was at the Roxy, and when it I remember where I was at the Roxy and when it came on the first time, and it was just like lighting a match to gasoline, because we'd already had the success with the Thunderpuss version, and you know, our goal was to, like, let's just keep this thing going, and wow, we have another great version. And 2000, when it was flipping to 2000, Kenny G had a record out, he did the Auld Lang Syne, and it had all of the different snippets of, like, you know, Reagan speaking, Kennedy, you know, all the great speeches that one does. And Clive Davis had already gone on vacation. I'm like, I gotta see. I always tried to break. I tried to break the rules a little bit. Tried to do things on the DL. And I'm like, Johnny, here's all that vocal stuff. Like, I know I can't clear that in time or whatever, but can you do an Auld Lang Syne remix of Kenny G? He did it. We printed 1,000 white label copies. I got it out before New Year's Eve, and you know. Story I haven't told to many people, but never came out, but it was out. Whoever has that vinyl, it's something special. So
do you have that vinyl?
I do have that vinyl. My handwriting is the label. I mean, Johnny Vicious did Spotlight for Jennifer Hudson. I mean, I can think of a lot of stuff that
yeah, he definitely, I mean, you know, he definitely did so many remixes. And as well as original production as well.
All the stuff he did with Salsoul, and you know, doing remixing the Lolita Holloway stuff. I mean, and the Vicious Music stuff. I mean, that got slammed in New York. Like, big room. Johnny Vicious, big room.
He definitely dominated the tri-state area for sure. Like one of the ones that the tri-state area, you couldn't go anywhere in the tri-state area without hearing a Johnny Vicious record, for sure.
I think that's the truth.
All right, so we got Razor and Guido.
You know, again, love these guys. Guido, rest in peace. Razor, Peter. You know, my memories of them are hanging out at Twilo. But it's Victor. We had a little group of industry guys, you know, that were always hanging out in a certain part of the below the booth. And whether it's Motomo or that kid Chris, or you can name it, Freeburn and Yurik, and waiting, you know, see what record, you know, Junior would play. And, you know, when Junior broke, Do It Again. Yes, yes. Da, 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 yeah, Do It Again. I mean, that was such a moment. And obviously, they were super talent. And I gave them their first remix, which was Robert Miles' Fable. And then with Do It Again, I'm like, you know, Aretha has Here We Go Again. Let's just flip that and make it Here We Go Again, kind of a play on Do It Again. So we did that. And, you know, great, great, great guys. And, you know, Guido. Not only was Guido a great remixer, but he was a great mix engineer. We talked to Escape and others that it always brought Guido in to fix little details that needed to be happening. And it's very sad that he's no longer with us.
But his music is with us forever.
Forever.
Razor and Guido in this round faces Thunderpuss.
I've told the story many times. Maybe some people haven't heard it, but I went to hear, I think it was Max Rodriguez or Billy Carroll at Splash. Maybe it was Billy, maybe it was Max. And they played Kiss the Rain. And I knew that It's Not Right was coming, you know, to be the single for Whitney. And when Kiss the Rain by Billy Myers came on, I was like, I went right up to the booth and I said, who is this? And like, Thunderpuss 2000. I'm like, I've never heard of them. So I went and looked up in her head, and I called them up and I'm like, you want to give Whitney Houston a shot? And they're like, yeah. And the little detail on that was, and I remember, and I hope they remember this, because I remember it clearly. The whole record is bump, 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 my recollection is that in the very first version of that, that was only in the break.
Wow.
And I thought that that was so awesome. And I said, you got to make the whole record. And
wow, so they actually only used it in the break?
To my recollection,
yeah,
that it was just, it wasn't not in the whole record. It wasn't like at the beginning or anything like that. And that was such a signature part of the record. And like, you know, you got to start the record with that. And by the way, I often say that to a lot of people, even to this very day, when I hear such a great thing in the break of the record, I'm like, why don't you make that the whole record? Why do we have to wait 3/4 of the way to get into a record to hear the best part of the record?
Which back then would have been like 3 minutes, right? 3 or 4 minutes.
Yeah, at least. So that started out an amazing relationship with Barry and Chris. And obviously they went on to like remix almost everybody. Their Mary J. Blige remix was one of my favorites.
Yeah, actually, I was working at MCA at that time with Mark Davenport. And I remember, you know, they called us. They wanted the a cappella to Mary J. Blige, No More Drama. And we're like, yeah, sure. So, and they came up. And what was interesting about their No More Drama remix, they didn't, they basically had 3 tempo changes in the record. They didn't just make it 126 or 128 through the whole mix. There was 3 separate tempo changes in the record, which I thought was brilliant, which Mary thought was brilliant. She, you know, cause she had to obviously approve of everything. And I do recall seeing on one of Chris Cox's live streams, he actually talked about the remix and talked about the 3 tempo changes. So
I have, I remember a record with another person you're going to bring up that we also did that exact same thing earlier than that.
Yeah. Well, maybe they were inspired by that.
No, I don't know. Well, you know, look, Chris and Barry are really smart guys, mm-hmm. and there's no question that they had the musicality to understand how to make a record sound great. You know, they did some of the things that might not be so obvious. They did Luther's Heaven, Can't Heaven Wait for Me, and the dub on that. If people haven't gone back and listened to the dub on Luther's Can't Heaven Wait, go do that. It is phenomenal. I mean, it brings you to another place. You know, maybe Chris or Barry on their live streams has played it. I don't know.
Well, that's the one thing I will say, like, to your point, one thing that I loved about Barry and Chris is they were masters at, I mean, particularly Barry, they were masters at, you know, chopping vocals and making them sound, like, even if they were not, like, you know, even if they weren't like syncing correctly, they made it sync. They made it work within with their remix, and they were really good at chopping vocals up. So that's what I loved about their productions.
Yeah, I mean, domination. I mean, they and look, I feel proud to look. Billy Myers definitely started off, but I think that Whitney Houston. And the thing with It's Not Right, But It's Okay, much like you were talking about Missing, the remix version became bigger than the original version.
Yeah, that's the one we played on KTU.
I mean,
and Z100.
I still hear it to this day. I sometimes turn on the radio and I hear it, or I hear it in a store, and it puts a smile on my face because, you know, we worked on that. We worked on that remix, you know, and it broke from the clubs too. It did break from the clubs. I remember going to a lot of clubs. You know, I believe in the personal delivery system, you know, giving certain DJs the first copies and all of that. And, you know, what I think that you have to give them a lot of credit for is taking a record, and Hex as well, because Hex did that also with Heartbreak Hotel. For Whitney and I Will Always Love You. But it, you know, Whitney had not made a lot of, the last music that she made was Bodyguard. This is the My Love Is Your Love album. And all of a sudden, she did get the dance community, the LGBT community. I mean, that locked them in, you know? So, you know, I feel that that was a highlight of my career.
All right. So now we go back to the other side of the bracket, and we got the S-Man, Roger Sanchez.
The man that has such a cool voice, he could do radio for days. Again, mad props to Roger, big fan. I didn't do a lot of work with him, but I did do Alicia Keys' Butterflies, which was very hard to do any Alicia Keys remixes. To get her approval was very tough, and we got that through, and really happy about that. Again, Roger's been around for a long time, and has done stuff. We've done stuff together, but I didn't use him on a ton of remixes.
Yeah, I mean, some of the stuff he's done a lot. I mean, working with Janet Jackson in towards late 2000s. I mean, probably 2005. I know he did like No Doubt, Hella Good. That was a pretty big Roger Sanchez. Roger Sanchez going up against Armand Van Helden.
I don't know about Armand being in the category of remixers, because he, I'll give you stories. Here's a story. Maybe it's a legend, and maybe it's
urban legend.
Urban legend, exactly. So Puffy wanted him to remix, and I think he did remix, been around all around the world. But Armand's like, I'll do it for $50,000, and they pay him. Armand was very, very selective in what he would remix. I know he did Snap before I got there. He, when I was there, we did Real McCoy. He did some dubs on that. Armand is, he's still happening today.
Well, like you said, like the urban legend, you know, he did remixes like Tori Amos' Professional Widow. The urban legend was he got $70,000 for that. I don't know.
Let's ask Johnny D.
Yeah, I know we would have to. I mean, yeah, but, you know, that's why I had him in my Sweet 16, because you had, like you said, you had the Real McCoy, but then you had Tori Amos, you had the Sneaker Pimps, you had CJ Bolin. Such, I mean, you know, he basically created a genre, which you remember Speed Garage was credited to him, basically. So I felt like he had to be in the Sweet 16. Now we're getting into Victor Calderon.
I love Victor. I mean, I love all these people, so I don't want to sound redundant. I mean, they're all amazing. Victor did Lisa Stansfield for me. Victor is a professional. I'll give you a memory of Victor, not necessarily from a remix standpoint, but from my mouth dropping standpoint. We went to Hammerstein Ballroom, and it's like, I think it was, I don't know if it was for Pride or for New Year's, but he had an orchestra. I went to his house. He showed me how he was going to do this. It was amazing. And then when I saw it being pulled off, I couldn't believe it. Relentless and Brain Bug. He starts playing the record, and then the curtain comes back, and there's like a 50-piece orchestra playing these records.
A 50-piece orchestra?
Something's mad like that.
Wow.
25 or 50 or what? It was a mad orchestra. And they are playing Relentless. I think they probably played Brain Bug and then Relentless. Somebody will correct me in the chat, I'm sure. But that's what you call an oh my God moment. And taking on something like that is genius. Victor
definitely, and I mean, he not only did he dominate in New York, but also Miami too, going back and forth.
A lot of these guys did, though.
Yeah.
You know? Especially if we get deeper into this. Victor just really such a professional, and knew what he wanted. He was very particular. I find him to be great and a friend.
All right. So we have Victor Calderon going up against Peter Rawhofer.
I think he was the best dance producer from, say, 95 till the time of his passing.
I felt like he was ahead of his time.
He was ahead of his time. You know, he did not make circuit music.
But the circuit played him, though.
That's the key. So if had he not passed away, had he lived, because there's always, I see on the boards, that there's always like the gay community has not moved on from the circuit, you know? They've kept that alive and well forever. It might be changing. It might be a little bit more housier now. But for decades, it just stayed circuit. I believe that if Peter was still alive, that he would have single-handedly changed that, because he didn't play circuit. There are so many incredible remixes that Peter did, not only from me, but Depeche Mode, It's No Good.
Yeah, that's one of my favorites.
All the Star 69 stuff, you know, just really, and look, Peter and I got into it. And, you know, also, God rest his soul, Orlando Puerta, you know, worked a lot with Peter too, because they were tight as well. I mean, you know, Peter and I, we would get into it. Like, you know, I want you, can you do this? And I don't want to do that. And, but it was, there was such a mutual respect. And look, he killed it. I mean, you know, the record, he did Beautiful. You know, that was an amazing, he did Any Less, 1,000 Beautiful Things. And the thing that I remember, a true story about Peter, is when he was doing, he actually did 17 again. He had it on his laptop, and Eurythmics, and he was in my office, and we were working on it together. And he was going by the name Club 69. And I said, Peter, what is Club 69? What's your name on the record? Peter Rawhofer. And I believe that's the first time he actually put his real name on a record.
On the Eurythmics remix.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm thinking about it. Yeah, because like when he did Depeche Mode, that wasn't a Peter Rawhofer remix. That was Club 69.
He had gone back to saying it's a Club 69 mix, but he started using his name. And I think that helped build his brand to be, you know, what it is, because people saw his name. He was no longer an alias, you know. DJs use your name, you know. I could sit here for an hour giving you stories about Peter.
I wonder, yeah, like you said, I wonder what Peter would have done for dance music if he's still around today, like what kind of, because he was always, like I said, I always felt like he was ahead of everyone. Like, what was the sounds that he would be doing today?
And his production skills were so tight. You know, even though it's beyond the period, you know, I did the I Look to You remixes. I think that's one of the last remixes that we did with Whitney. And Peter was doing that. We were working on it. And I was at the Roseland Ballroom, which is also gone now, and you know, he was gonna play it. He was gonna like make a good thing. And I go in the booth, and I'm like, okay, Peter, when are you gonna play I Look to You? And he's like, I forgot it at home. I said, go get somebody, get it and bring it back. Which he did, and he played, and you know, it was went off, but
wow, you made him send somebody to get that record.
I mean, you don't make Whitney Houston remix and not debut it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
Look, I don't know, whatever, but it was a love hate relationship.
We're going back to the right side bracket. Robbie Rivera.
He did Product G&B with Santana.
Love that one. One of my all-time favorites.
And he absolutely crushed it. My memory of that is pretty awesome. Junior had moved to Earth, which could literally fit like just like Palladium, 5,000 to 7,000 people. And this was a packed night. And I'm on the railing looking down, and Junior drops it. And it gets the crowd going a little bit. And then he mixes it into a bootleg of the Doobie Brothers. Okay? Long Train Run. And he kind of sucker punches people for the Doobie Brothers. And then it goes right back, like perfectly mixed into Prodigy and B. And that damn with the Carlos Santana and that rumbling boom, 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 boom. And again, I know Jonathan did it, and Junior, those are the two people that come to mind when they would play a record literally for over a half an hour, 45 minutes.
45 minutes, yeah.
And the crowd is just destroyed. So if there's anybody that's young that hadn't had a chance to experience that, there was nothing like being and seeing a record work for 45 minutes. Nothing. And you broke a record that day. That day, that record was broken. And people would talk about that night. And then DJs from Atlanta and Miami and all up and down the East Coast and eventually moved out to the West Coast, they would play the record. So, Robbie is a super talent and obviously has his own record label and partnered with Strictly Rhythm now, and it's doing great.
All right, so we were just talking about Robbie Rivera, which brings us to our next producer, the one and only Hex Hector.
What can you say? Hex Hector is my man. Hex, along with Soul Solution, did Unbreak My Heart, which really kind of got me more into the remix game, having been a club DJ, because Unbreak My Heart became so big, the dance version, it 4 weeks number one on the club chart. I don't know if there's anything that has beaten that. And it was a double A single as well, and it was huge internationally. Because internationally, they weren't so big on the ballad. So the up-tempo version was major, and then when Tony performed on the AMAs and Grammys, the slow to fast version, I mean, that just kind of opened the floodgates for like, wow, you could take a ballad and really remix it into a dance anthem. And after that, I gave Hex a Brandy remix, which he absolutely destroyed. He destroyed. I mean, like, I didn't think he, like, this guy, something's going on, okay? And, from then on out, it was like, things just ain't the same with Deborah Cox. And, he did obviously, as a lot of people know, he did a lot of the Deborah Cox remixes, Nobody's Supposed to Be Here, which is an all-timer. Something that I learned from Clive Davis is that if somebody is really hot and they get it, like I could tell, like I remember, working with Hex and, like talking about a break, for instance, all right? I didn't need to tell him like real specific stuff. I just asked, can we give it this kind of feeling? And he would know immediately what to do. And then he would come back and I'm like, damn, he got it. But Hex also did a couple, he did other remixes besides Deborah. He did Lisa Stansfield's I'm Leaving, which was amazing. And I have to give him credit because we did two different versions. We did one that was a little bit more mainstream, and he did one that he really liked a lot, which was more underground and tribal. And I'm like, you know what? Let's put them both out. That was the beauty of a 12-inch. We put one New York City underground mix and one, the club mix. And that was a huge, huge record and helped, bring about the Lisa Stansfield remix EP. A huge mix that he did was Angie Stone's Wish I Didn't Miss You. I mean, that was major. It was major. Yeah. It put Angie on the map in the dance community.
Yeah.
And of course, he did, I learned from the best, Whitney. I remember, that Hex and I were in a studio and Whitney was in, we did this remotely, but we were cutting vocals with her. And he also did I Will Always Love You, the remix on that, which is not an easy one to do. And they were all featured on that, you know, which I'm, something I'm really proud of was the Whitney box set that had all of the big, humongous remixes of Whitney Houston prior to her greatest hits coming out. That was awesome. And of course, his Jennifer Lopez, you know, that he did for Columbia, Waiting for Tonight. I mean,
legendary.
You know.
Yeah, she. I mean, she used it in her Super Bowl appearance.
That was amazing. I mean, trust me, when I was watching that, I was like, "That's Hex-a-Mex."
Yeah, I think everybody were like, "Hex, Hex." You know, it's like, I mean, can you share with me the experience that you had with Hex when he won the Grammy for Best Remixer?
I invited Hex to the Clive Davis's Grammy party, so we all sat down there. I mean, it was, it felt great, you know?
Do you remember if he cried or was he, I mean, what was his reaction like when he heard that he won?
I wasn't with him actually at the Grammy. He'd come to Clive's party, so I don't know, but I know that he deserved to win.
Absolutely.
And I felt that, you know, I played a little bit of part of it. But
not a little, a lot of part of it.
Hex and Mac were unstoppable. I mean, they really were. And they had, and the key to their success, which I recognized, I think, early on, was they were able to make a record that worked for the clubs, wasn't too underground, could get played in radio mix shows, even make it some radio, you know, get regular radio play. It was just that nice fine line balance.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, you see, Mac has gone on to be such a great music supervisor in California.
I mean, yeah, Mac Quayle. I mean, I was blown away because I used to watch, well, I still watch Mr. Robot, and he does the entire music for that TV show, and I won awards for it too, and just blown away. It's so great to see how many people you have personally worked with that have gone on to do such great things even to this day. So it's a testament to you of just recognizing talent.
Right. I that feels weird when you say that, but I appreciate it. I actually, you know what? Somebody taught me to say, never take a compliment and turn it into a negative. So I want to thank you for that. All right. So, cause that's bad karma when you do that.
Yeah, no, take them, because you know what, as I was telling you privately, like, you have really shaped the way dance music is today. You played a big part of it, whether you want to like accept it or not, but you really did, and you really did play a very big part of how dance music was shaped, not just in this country but internationally as well, just like you had said with Toni Braxton, with Unbreak My Heart, with all of the great remixers and producers that you've worked with over the years.
I think we were very fortunate that New York was the epicenter of dance culture at that time, and the talent that was in New York and also in Miami. And New York had a really, you know, very strong relationship with Miami.
Yeah, we always joke around, Miami's the sixth borough of New York City.
Having gone to the, you know, when the Winter Music Conference was big, New York would be the promoters for most of the parties down there. So we controlled Miami up to a point. So you see all of the New York parties go down there. Then Miami got hip to that after a while. They're like, why are we paying all these New Yorkers, you know, this money to bring their stuff down here? We'll just we'll throw our own parties and hire the DJ. So, but you know, it lasted for a good long time. And you know, I remember escaping at the Cameo and dropping Monica, Scum Frog's version. I don't even remember what record that was, but I remember it breaking in one night. You know, it was just amazing. So gone. I mean, I could give you a million stories.
So that was Hex Hector, which brings us to our final bracket. We only have two left in our Sweet 16. Danny Tenaglia.
A show of hands. Who doesn't like Danny Tenaglia? Does anyone hate on Danny Tenaglia? No one.
No one hates Danny.
Danny is one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet. You know, he is just, he's always happy. I didn't work with Danny much. There's a couple mixes I offered him, but that weren't the right fit. But I would hear him play, and, you know, again, a journey, like a really good play for, you know, a long, long time, marathon sets. And what I remember about Danny is, even more so than his remixes, his productions, the Green Velvet Flash or Music Is the Answer. I mean, how many times, you know, Colonel Abrams, obviously, is the first one that did that, but I mean, Music Is the Answer. I mean, that's still to this day, kids are playing around with that phrase. Bottom Heavy, how about Elements? And where we put the different pieces of the record and to come in and out. And that was so great. His Detour album, that brand. You know, he worked mostly with Rob DiStefano with Twisted. Mm-hmm. And he did a lot of stuff with Tribal America. Danny is one of the most professional guys in the business.
He won a Grammy for Depeche Mode, I Feel Love. So, I mean, he's done it all. I mean, you know, he had some great remixes. Also, I played this a couple of times on my classic stream on the Danny Tenaglia Greatest Remixes album. Had the Eurythmics, Danny Tenaglia remix for Sweet Dreams, Alternate, New Kind of Medicine. Yeah, I mean, Danny, he was definitely doing that kind of more alternative remixes, I guess you could say, right? You know,
I mean, I remember when I got his remix of Janet Jackson's Pleasure Principle.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, whoa. I mean, that was just like, I mean, I put that in so many mixes, I can't even count. It was... He definitely had more of that European edge that he inserted and also had a really solid ground in Miami as well, both here in New York and in Miami.
I could tell you, when I first moved to New York in 95, I remember hearing him play Funky Green Dogs Fired Up. And I remember that night because Armand was in the building also, and a couple of other DJs, and we all looked up and we're like, what is this? Like, amazing. Just, what is this? You know, he had that, and we talked about this before. We talked about how the New York City club life was just, it's not matched by anything else. Like you were saying earlier, like a festival doesn't match the experience that we experienced in the clubs when a DJ would drop a song for the first time and the crowd would just lose it, you know?
I think that's because we appreciated the music. Well, first of all, music had more of a staying power. Like we were talking about, you know, how, like, you know, I still commission remixes now and then, but I don't feel the same attachment to the ones that were done, you know, back, you know, when there was vinyl, you know?
Yeah.
Because DJs played them longer. They were more exclusive. It just had a little bit more stickiness to it.
Yeah, and that's why, like, I guess I chose this era to do the Battle of the Remixers from 95 to 2005, because this was definitely a special moment in dance music. Like, just from what we said, and the talent that you like you said earlier, that came from New York City at that time was just brilliant and amazing.
I think that kind of leads up to the last person, right?
Yes, which brings us to
Junior! You got 10 hours?
We got to give the condensed version.
You know, a condensed version be like maybe an hour?
I mean, it is kind of crazy, you know, looking at his discog just in the 90s, not including the 2000s, he has over 3,000 releases in the 90s. I mean, if you can, and if you can combine the 90s and the 2000s, you know, going from 1990 to 2010, you're talking 5,000 releases. And it's...
I don't think it's actually fair to put him in this bracket, to be honest. I'm just going to put it out there. Look, so much talk, rightfully so, Larry Levan, like the first big DJ that set the tone for major DJs, obviously also David Mancuso from The Loft, but Junior inherited what Larry did to a whole new generation. So there's all the garage heads, and look, I went to the garage one time, but I played all of those records when I was in college, on college radio, all the garage classics, so I live for garage music. But what Junior did is he took what Larry did, gave it his own spin, and lasted for generations and generations. When I was working as music director at KMEL, I would fly to New York once a month to hear Junior play and go to the other clubs as well. And Junior, as Larry, could take a room and turn it any kind of way he wanted to. I saw a post the other day remembering him where he decided not to play music for about 10 minutes. And he would just do a kick drum. And people started clapping. I mean, two kick drums. He played Wind for a while. He had the crowd by his hand. And all of the DJs, majority of them, maybe I'll take Morales and Frankie out of that, but and maybe Masters at Work, they all owe, as well as I do, a lot of their career to Junior Vasquez. Because Junior broke so many records. I had a policy. My policy was, if I had an acapella, Junior gets it right away. No matter who else I hired for the remix, Junior gets the acapella. Because he would break the record. He would play a record for an hour. I mean, it was insane. So I first met Junior. I mean, I had met Junior when I came from San Francisco. I'd have people bring me up to the booth and they introduced me. But I really met him at a Winter Music Conference. I believe it was 94. And we were at the Warsaw. And he was just standing right next to me, you know, on the side. And I'm like, hi, Junior. I'm Hosh Gureli. I work at Arista Records. You're such a great DJ, blah, blah, blah. And at that time, I had the Annie Lennox parts of No More I Love Yous. And I'm like, would you like to do a mix of this? And he's like, yeah, sure. Let me. And that was my beginning of my, you know, formal and personal relationship with Junior. And he turned out No More I Love Yous. And, I went to Sound Factory religiously. I was there the night it closed, along with Carmen Cacciatore and Victor Lee. I was telling you the story before. It was like 8 a.m. and we're just hanging on the bar. And all of a sudden they started giving out the waters. And we're like, why? You know, they never give you anything free. Oh, yeah, it's the last night of the club. What? Within an hour, the club repacked and stayed till 10 p.m. I didn't stay till 10 p.m., but it was open till
10 p.m. And Junior played till 10 p.m.?
100%. Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
And always played MacArthur's Park, The Last Dance, you know, the song so many times. You know, memories that I have. Right off, I mean, he did so many great mixes, for me and Arista. Cucumber Zoo. I'm going to mention some of the non-obvious ones, like The Child Inside. You turn that thing on, and I was like, oh my God, it just sounded so fresh. And I'm scared, you're scared. And he did the, you know, his own mix of Who You Love by Deborah that was on DMC. And we later released that. That was a big tunnel record. I remember him just playing. When he could really mix, he would celebrate New Year's Eve at noon on the next day. So we wouldn't get to the club. We'd sleep the night before. We get to the club, like I remember getting to the club at 8 o'clock in the morning, and it was so packed you couldn't even breathe. And I'm like, we gotta, you know, fortunately there was a little booth room that we could go to. But at noon I don't know if it was the New Year 2000 or what, but he played three records right on top of each other. I'll never forget this moment because it was unbelievable. He played Relentless, In the Mix, and Can You Party, all at the same time, but one going above the other and then one fighting for it, and they were like in sync. It was incredible. And like the place was screaming out of their minds. So, you know, if people had never heard Junior at that time, I'm telling you, there was nothing like it in the world. And then when he went to Arena for that 1 year, that was something entirely different. I mean, like Dolly Parton, Peace Train, you know, the Elton John, Rocket Man. He wouldn't mix. He would play with the records, but then it would stop, and people would clap, and then he'd start another record. You know, my favorite record was Living It Up, Ricky Lee Jones. I mean, that was a call to arms, or Jars of Clay. I mean, I can go on, like I told you, I could do an hour. But he played so many of other people's records. So whether it was like Razor and Guido, okay? Like they had done the remix for me for More Money, More Problems, you know, Puffy's record. Junior would drop that Arena and it would go down to the remix broke down. I mean, the place went nuts. He would play Johnny's records, Hex's records, Escape's records. He would play everyone's records. And that's why the industry galvanized themselves to go and hear Junior play. We would just be all in our little room. What's he going to play next? What's he going to play next? And, you know, it's funny. He knew we were all there. I mean, I had many a time where he would, like, search me out of the crowd and put a spotlight on me to make me nervous or whatever. And he had and I think this is also, he took this from Larry, but when I felt like it was time to leave the club, of course, I'm going up the stairs to go to leave. And of course, one of my big records would drop. So he'd pull me right back in. And he did that to so many other industry people or friends of his. You know, his discography is crazy. Step by Step, which is one of my favorite remixes that I've ever participated with anyone with. I remember being in the studio with him and Gomi. And, you know, to keep Whitney's vocal intact, we had to keep it at the original tempo of, you know, Step by Step, which Annie also did the backgrounds on. And then do that to get up to the energetic part. But to find that sound, you know, that in the break, I remember Gomi was flipping through a bunch of sounds, and I felt like I had a little part of more than just A&R-ing the record. I was like, he came to that sound. I'm like, that's the sound. That's what's got to be in that part, and he put that in there, and you know, it became one of his signature, you know, anthemic records. But he did records for so many people, you know, the Madonnas, the Cyndi Laupers, all the Christine Dubs,
and all the big names, really.
Everyone. And so many times his remixes only played in his room because they were such big room mixes. And if you didn't have that mentality like say in a smaller market, which maybe some of your listeners are in, you know, you couldn't play those records there because people would not know what you're doing.
Right. Yeah, that was the thing. Yeah, like, yeah, especially like in the Midwest, like they didn't understand the breakdowns, those long breakdowns where there's like no drums or anything, but it was Junior creating that drama for Arena or wherever. And like you said, you don't understand unless you experience it for yourself, being on the dance floor and feeling the tension that he would give people on the dance floor, you know.
You nailed it with the word drama, because that's what Junior is, drama. he lived for it.
Yeah, you know, going back to what you were saying, that's, I remember a couple of times when you're talking about how the industry always is, every DJ in New York City, they all ended up at Arena at like 5 a.m. in the morning. After a night of us DJing wherever we were at, we all ended up listening to Junior at 5 a.m., 6 a.m. in the morning, going, what is that? Like, where can we get that? Like, I mean, everyone from Escape, I would see Scribble there. I would see everybody.
Scribble gives Junior credit for getting him into house music. You know, it's...
Yeah, because I would see Scribble there. Yeah, he would do a hip-hop set, like, at whatever club, and he would be at Arena at 6 a.m., hanging out with all the DJs and the industry people, and we're all, wow, what is this? You know, every weekend was like, what is he playing? What is this?
And to give Junior credit, it's when he would play... at least I can say for myself, when he played the records that I worked on, he would break them when he would play them, because he would work them so hard that other people would tell them about their experience. And so then it got played in Miami and in Atlanta, all up and down the East Coast, and then it would, you know, start to go to the West Coast. But he would, I mean, when I gave him It's Not Right, But It's Okay, my God, you know, he, with Barry and Chris, he would play that thing, I'm telling you, 45 minutes, but he would play it differently than you'd hear anybody else play it, you know, with his loops and his echoes. I mean, I could literally give you a list of, you know, 50 records that he broke. I mean, we did Angie Stone at Earth. We had her perform there because Hex's mix got so big, him playing it, and she had like 15 dancers with hula hoops. It was an experience. The one thing I will say with Junior that was very important, as was with Larry Levan, is that when he was at the Sound Factory, when he was at Twilo, not so much Earth or Arena, but they had the most amazing sound systems. You know, whether it's the Phazon sound system or the Richard Long sound system, it was. I mean, I can remember one time being sitting on the stairs, and I felt like I had headphones on. I could hear every little hi-hat, it was like, you know, and you don't hear that anywhere. People do not concentrate as much on the sound as they used to, and it's a little upsetting.
And it's more on the visual now. They're definitely paying more. You know, a lot of venues are paying more attention to the visual as opposed to the audio, which is a shame.
Yeah. So let me put a disclaimer, because when you asked me to do this, I really didn't know what this whole bracket thing was. I didn't even know when you did the Divas thing. So then when I looked, and I'm seeing you're actually pairing people against each other, I'm like, that's not really fair. So I am not choosing anyone over anybody, because I think they all should win. Okay,
absolutely. You know what? And that's why I do have the Sweet 16, because all of these remixers that I have here, but believe me, it was really hard to do, because I could easily have made this 30, you know, 30 DJs.
Some honorable mentions like That Kid Chris, or
Deep Dip. Deep Dish. We talked about Jason Nevins.
Jason Nevins, exactly. I brought him up. You know, there's so many.
Yeah, especially in this period, in this 1995, 2005. I remember seeing some people saying, you know, Lenny Bertolo. Lenny B. He did a lot of remixes as well. And then obviously, like I said in the beginning of the show, people were saying, oh, what about the Euros? But I wanted to keep this, obviously, New York City centric, New York City based, because this was the era of dance music that I felt New York City was, like you said, the center of the mecca of dance music. So there we have it. We have our Sweet 16 this Sunday, July 26th, 10 p.m. Eastern Time, Battle of the Remixers. You know, before we go, is there anything you want to say?
So look, without having great promoters to promote your records, your club records to the panel and to DJs all over the place, you need them. And, you know, I'm friends with all of them, you know, Orlando, Frank Sorello, Brad LeBeau, Claudia Cassetta,
David Henney, rest in peace.
David Henney, rest in peace, Joe Bernardo. But I have to give a major shout out to Bobby Shaw, because Bobby worked all my records and, you know, also a close friend. He knew me from back in my Boston days and, you know, really has done a lot of the records that we put out justice.
Yeah, Bobby is a industry legend as well. We should probably do a show just on him, on all the records that he's worked.
He got lots of stories.
I mean, I remember him telling me some Prince stories, some Madonna stories. Dance music, when you think about it, it all goes hand in hand with obviously the DJs and the producers, but like you said, you know, the behind the scenes people that make it happen with the promoters too. So big props to them.
And thanks to all the DJs that played the records back then.
Well, of course, that goes without saying. I mean,
say it.
Yeah. I mean, that's why I started DJing in, I could say this, but I started DJing in 87. But man, just this period of time, I feel like everybody talks about the 80s and the like early 90s. But I feel like this from 95 to 2005 hasn't gotten that shine yet. And I think I'm hoping that it does, because this was a great period for dance music.
I tell you, you say 95, Junior was at the Tunnel in 95, okay? And he went to the Palladium Arena September 96th. And to me, that's when the underground kind of got mixed in with the commercial. So it is a different kind of time period, because the Sound Factory and the Garage were really just underground. That was underground, okay? And in 96, and then also with Jonathan coming onto the scene as well, you felt that it was still underground, but it had reached some of the boroughs, you know, and in Long Island and Jersey, and bigger crowds. So you'd have more like, you know, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 people, which I think if you told anybody today that, yeah, 5,000 people would come to the club on a weekly basis, they'd be like, what? But it did happen.
No, I mean, that's exactly how I remember it. I mean, I would literally go to bed on a Saturday night. I'd go to bed like, you know, maybe 9 o'clock Saturday night, wake up 3 a.m., 4 a.m. and go to Factory. And there will be 3,000 people there at 5 a.m. till Lord knows how long in the afternoon till Jonathan Peters decided to stop playing at Sound Factory.
When you say the Factory, to me, that's the Sound Factory on the 27th Street. I love Jonathan Peters.
Right.
Sound Factory, you know, Richard Grant putting the name there. Look, Jonathan has his own legacy. It felt a little weird to me, but all good.
No, I'm just saying, but even
none of it's there anymore.
even with junior like arena, the same thing. I would go to bed early, wake up 3-4 a.m. in the morning, and then go to arena. And there would be, you know, 2,000-3,000 people there. Like
everyone's going, children.
It was, yeah, we don't have those experiences, and obviously we won't have them for a very long time, if ever.
That's done. I think we lived the life, and that's over, and just let's cherish it and see what comes next.
Yeah.
You know, what I hope to happen during this time of being, you know, incarcerated in your house, self-quarantined, is that some new music, something completely different emerges, you know, whether it be pop or dance, and that it just is fresh because people are thinking a little bit more about how to be creative.
Well, I do think that you are starting to hear that now, that music is definitely getting up-tempo again. Dua Lipa, obviously, doing up-tempo. Lady Gaga's album is like 90s dance music, you know?
Her album was Bad Back and Bad Romance.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're in an interesting time. Like, I feel like 120 is the new, you know, I think we're finally getting out of the, you know, 100, 110, you know, down-tempo dance thing, and it seems like we're 120 is the new tempo. So,
well, I'm telling you,
I'm okay with that.
When this thing ends, people are they're going to want to go out and dance.
Sure. Yeah. So once again, thank you again, Hosh. This Sunday, Battle of the Remixers, 10 p.m. Eastern Time on my Twitch channel, twitch.tv/DJRiddlerMusic. Also on Facebook. We'll see you there. Thanks again, Hosh, for sharing all of your experiences. And
my pleasure, Rich. Anything for you. Take care.
See you Sunday.